unfortunately got attacked by a gang of local youths, so the visit was cut short at that point. They contacted ourselves, police contacted ourselves, and this led to a joint visit on the 10th of February with the police officer and my colleague to my left, Joanne Moran. On entrance to premises, on this occasion, there was one male working in the shop behind the counter, and when PC Divine spoke to him, it appeared that he had poor understanding of what was happening, and he was unable to answer simple questions put to him. He asked if there was anyone else working there. The male used his mobile phone, and shortly afterwards a second male appeared at the shop. Both males appeared confused what was happening, and both had or didn't have the ability to answer basic questions. The male stated they were both from South India, and after a length of time and being asked directly, both of the males admitted they were not in the UK legally. They stated they lived above the premises and worked many hours over 7 days a week. My colleague Jo asked if she could speak to the owner of the shop. Using the mobile phone, they telephoned, and Jo then spoke to Matha Nakaran, Selvana Yakab, so MS, on the mobile phone. And Mr. S told the licensing officer that he bought the shop a few months ago.
How many months? How many months before?
He just said a few months ago. Yeah. And he was going to apply to transfer the premises license, again, in inverted commas, next week. Mr. S was asked if the CCTV could be viewed at the premises, and he advised he couldn't access the system because the person he bought the shop from, Mr. SS, had the password, so he couldn't show or instruct his staff to show the CCTV. Interestingly, Mr. S later stated to Joe, that's not the case, reference to the CCTV password. He didn't have control of the CCTV. During the visit, the licensing officer asked Mr. S, was he still involved in the shop? If Mr. S was still involved in the shop, because in accordance with the license, he was still the license holder and DPS. He told the officer that he was still involved, but again, he repeated he was going to apply to transfer the license into his name. Apologies, that is Mr. Sullivan. This is Mr. Sullivan Yakam. He stated that
Mr. MS stated that
SS was going to transfer, if that helps. Yeah. When asked about the two males, I don't have the first name, so I don't know which one's which, so I'll just use their full name. Mr. Salvan Yakam stated they both lived in Manchester, the two males, and he'd look up the home address for the officer, and police officer, and call back. He then did ring back, and when he rang back, on the mobile phone that he rang, which belonged to one of the two workers, came up Premier Boss on the screen, as if that was the name, the number was saved. That's it. This male, who was believed to be someone else, we do not know who was now on the phone, provided an address in Eccles, Manchester, where both males were alleged to have been living, albeit they previously stated, we live upstairs. As a result of their early admissions, that they did not have the right to leave the UK, the police officer tried to contact his colleagues in immigration, but was unable to at that time. They were cautioned and arrested, and later handed across to spoken with Mr. Thorpe outside just about two other visits that took place. On the 13th of February, there was a visit pre-arranged at the premises with Mr. Mathanakaran, who claimed to, he was the person who claimed to have bought the business, and he was there with his mother, and it was about what happened a few days prior. He stated he'd bought the shop in September. Bear in mind it was apparently sold in March, but he claimed he bought it in September. He Mr. Mathanakaran.
What's his initials?
MS.
Like June or which?
Apologies, Manada. Yeah, Mathanakaran is Mr. Sullivan. Purchased the business in September, and he's the person who was telephoned during the visit, and then someone went back and provided addresses and papers. So during this pre-arranged visit, MS stated that he'd upgraded the CCTV in the shop and was asked for a download of the CCTV. It's never been produced, didn't respond to the emails further asking for that evidence. He was asked about the two males who were there working on the previous Friday, which was the 10th February. He said that they were just helping him out and I didn't pay them. So he claims they were just helping out, but he didn't pay them. And that's what happened on the 13th.
These are the two that lived above the shop and worked 7 days a week.
And then were arrested, Chair. Yeah. So they were apparently working there for free. And then on the 17th of May, fast forward now to the 17th of May, a visit took place in conjunction with a police officer and Joe Moran. During this visit, there was a young girl working with the premises who 17th of May. She claimed to live above the premises, and she also claimed that she was a student permitted to work up to 20 hours per week. When asked about her studies, she advised that she studies in Coventry on Mondays, Wednesdays and Fridays. This visit on the 17th of May was a Wednesday, and it was around about 13:30. She stated she was due in college in Coventry at 3 p.m. And she
What time was she being spoken to?
1:30. And she claims that she gets to college in Coventry by taxi. But she was still working in the shop at 1:30 on the Wednesday. to do with the amount of liquid in disposable vapes. There's a legal limit, which is 2 millilitres. That equates to about 600 puffs, it's called. So the disposable vapes, you get around about 600 puffs, which is the equivalent nicotine of a pack of 20 cigarettes. So the legal limit is 600. The vapes that were seized ranged from 3,500 to 7,000 puffs, which is way beyond the legal limit of disposable vapes. So I was made aware that happened. Trading standards seized the vapes. I believe these matters are ongoing. They need to get them sent away and tested, etc., before they make their decision. But I'm afraid I don't know anything more about their investigation. But for me, it just highlighted that the premises were selling illegal products, which I've been told by trading standards you should not obviously be able to buy through legitimate supply channels if you were going to reputable wholesalers, etc.
Andrew,
yes? Yes, 1st of June 2023.
And the amount of nicotine holds vapes?
Yeah.
That's a very serious thing. I mean, everyone's smoking that. Particularly children.
Yeah, I've had a conversation with trade standards, and I've become more knowledgeable on these now. And yes, it is, and that is a big concern.
Trading standards not here today.
No, they're not here today. This was obviously quite recent. It was way before, way after the consultation period, etc.
Okay.
Okay.
This is a good comment. Well, I'm going to let you speak in a bit. I'm not trying to shut you down. Anything you've got to say, I'm going to do with the representation. Okay.
The illegal activity that has taken place at this premises, I believe, has undermined the prevention of crime and disorder licensing objective, and has demonstrated that it's not able to operate legally. In my application, I refer to it as the current owner of the business. This was written prior to Ravi taking over. But in essence, MS failed to complete the necessary application to transfer the licence. He was the owner, and according to him, was the controlling mind of the business. Essentially, the premises illegally employed, paid or otherwise, two individuals who not only don't have the right to work, but were not in this country legally. The Licensing Act provides a clear focus on the promotion of the four objectives, as we all know. Preventive crime disorder is one of those four objectives. And there are no other, it's just those four objectives, and there are no others. Therefore, the promotion of these objectives is absolute key and paramount to how any premises is run at all times. The Act is fortified by guidance issued under Section 182 of the Act, and this guidance addresses immigration issues, immigration crime. And if I may just quote, it's quite short. The prevention of crime includes the prevention of immigration crime, including the prevention of illegal working in licensed premises. Licensing authorities should work with the Home Office, Immigration Enforcement, as well as the police in respect of these matters. The guidance goes on to say that there is certain criminal activity that may arise in connection with licensed premises, which should be treated particularly seriously. It lists a number of crimes, and one of those is relating to immigration crime. It's envisaged that licensing authorities, the police and the Home Office will use review procedures effectively to deter such activities and crime. Where reviews do arise and the authority determines that the crime prevention objective is being undermined, it's expected that revocation of the licence, even in the first instance, should be seriously considered. That's from the 182 guidance. Illegal immigration is not a victimless crime. The National Crime Agency states that organised immigration crime generates easy money for criminal groups, funds other forms of organised crime, and often endangers the lives of the migrants themselves. Entering the UK illegally prevents law enforcement from conducting criminal records or security checks, which means we don't know who they are or what risk they may pose to the UK.
And another point you make now about the legality of what? Can some of us go into find an address?
Indeed, it can't share, yeah. Okay. Very illegal, actually. So, through the employment of two illegal workers, this premises has
since 2015,